Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for coming out to the NRF Big Show 2018. We have a glorious day and a packed house, so congratulations. Thank you so much for coming out. A special thanks to all of our international delegates. It's so wonderful to have you guys visit us. Thank you for coming out. Today, we open up the Innovation Lab stage. There will be 15 sessions over 3 days, so there's quite a bit of good content here for you to look at. Excellent exhibits for you to see. A couple of quick housekeeping notes. If you would be so kind as to silence any cell phones, we would certainly appreciate that. And the other thing is that we would love to have you give us feedback on these sessions. Quite a bit of effort goes into putting these sessions together, and we want to make certain that we're serving your needs and addressing the things that you want to hear. So please let us know what you think. You can do that in the app that you can download. Without further ado, let me open up the first session by introducing the founder and managing director of XRC Labs, Mr. Pano Anthos. Pano, take it away.
Hi, y'all. How are you? So let's start with a show of hands. How many of you, retailers and brands, have implemented artificial intelligence today, as of now? Give us a show. Well, that's a pretty small number, folks. How about robotics? All right, equally small number. All right, well, we're gonna try to make some change here. We want this to be actionable. This is not a sales pitch. We're really after giving you some insights as to how to make this a reality, okay? So I'll start with what we're gonna do is introduce each panelist. They're gonna have a couple minutes to frame who they are, what they're doing, and how they think about AI or robotics. And then we'll get into some of the hard questions. Shall we get started? Great. So first, I'm Pano Anthos. I run a technology and retail consumer goods accelerator called XRC Labs. We've curated the innovation showcase on the other side, all the emerging platforms that you'll see there. And we focus on things like AI and robotics because we believe that change is necessary for retail and consumer goods to thrive. All right? With me next to me is Joe Jensen. He is the VP and General Manager of Retail for Intel. And next to me, Michelle Bachrach, the CEO of FineMind. And then Bernd Schoner, who's the CEO of DeepMagic. And last is Marco Mascoro, the CEO of Fellow Robots. So we're going to start with you, Joe. Give us a little background on what you're up to.
So at Intel, we believe more data makes everything better. And we're at a point now where it's very cost effective and easy to get access to the data that's occurring in the store, how your shoppers are moving, how products are moving, and the technologies around AI have matured very quickly, and we're at a point now where it's cost effective with a fantastic ROI to actually turn that data into simple actionable insights for your staff. And so we think the time is right now, and we really believe that data is the key to the future of retailing. If you look at online retailers, you know, they have access to tremendous amounts of data about how their shoppers are moving through their site and how their shoppers are interacting. You go into physical stores, you have huge advantages. The product is there, customers can interact with the product, you've got service and staff there that can help the customer. But what's missing today, and the thing that's really hampering physical retail, we think, is they're not really collecting the data that's occurring in the store at the edge and using that data to help augment their staff to really deliver that over-the-top experience.
Excellent. Michelle?
Hi, everyone. Hi, I'm Michelle Bachrach. I founded this company about 4 years ago because I'm selfish and I had a problem that I wanted to solve. I found that as a shopper, I was getting sold products one at a time when no one uses a product one at a time in their real life. So I would get sold a leather skirt and I would try it on in the store in my bare feet in my sports bra because I had just come from yoga. But of course, that's not how I can wear a leather skirt in regular life. I had to put an outfit together around it. And that information was consistently missing from my sales experience. So I would have to go on Pinterest or Polyvore or do all these, you know, things to try to figure out how to wear this leather skirt when if Bloomingdale's, who had sold me the skirt, had just showed me the outfit to wear with it, I would have probably spent a lot more money with Bloomingdale's. I did the research and found that it wasn't just me who had this problem, that there was a lot of other people who had it. And in fact, customers will spend up to 200% more when you show them how to wear what they're buying in fashion or how to use what they're buying really in any industry. So I was like, okay, I'm onto something here. I should solve this problem. So I created a company to do it. It just happened that artificial intelligence was the way to solve that problem. Because fashion is subjective, we have to try to replicate and scale the way a merchant would put together an outfit and the way that they would kind of craft the brand's point of view. because style is subjective, you kind of have to use more sophisticated technology to do it, and artificial intelligence, specifically supervised machine learning, was the only way we could do that. So my kind of big message that I always harp on when I'm on panels or talking to anyone about AI is don't think of AI as an end in itself. It's not. If you start there, you've already failed. It's a means to an end to solve a problem, so start with the problem first and then figure out ways to solve that problem. The way to solve it might be AI, but if there's an easier way to do it, forget AI and save some time.
Bert?
Good morning. DeepMagic is just under a year old, but prior to co-founding DeepMagic, I spent 15 years designing and trying to make RFID systems work for the retail industry. You all have, or many of you have seen what that looked like, and both lived through the frustrations. I realized at the end of that run that RFID is ultimately a very limited technology that gives you one bit of information about an object that you're looking at. If you compare that with computer vision and AI, you're looking at so much more and such a universe of information that you can extract from a camera image. So that's really the genesis of our company, using computer vision and AI to solve some of the RFID problems that we looked at before. And we challenged us to develop a system that would completely automate the retail transaction and make it frictionless. A lot of our fellow former colleagues at MIT are now designing self-driving cars. We decided that we would use those technologies to create frictionless retail in stores.
Excellent. Marco, welcome.
Thank you. Yeah, good morning. So my name is Marco. I'm co-founder and CEO of a company called Fellow Robots. And as we've been here a little bit, there's a lot of AI and robotics, right? And we sometimes don't realize how much AI we've been using already in our lives. All our emails, most of them are running in AI. So one of the things we're doing, obviously, in Fellow Robots is how do we use these cutting-edge technologies and start applying it to what is already out there, applying it to what's already in the systems, like databases, what we already run in our infrastructure, in our stores. And actually, that's a pretty interesting story, right? When we start implementing all these things without changing things in stores, it becomes really quite interesting. So we use computer vision, machine learning, artificial intelligence to see what's happening at the shelf level, and we provide metrics on what's happening, what's the ROI we need to do. On top of that, we also help customers that are in stores to run more efficiently their environments and the stores and have actually a really positive impact in the store. So that's what we do.
Okay, so what I'd like to do now is get into some examples. We've talked, generally speaking, about the businesses. I'd love to take it a little step further and give us an example of how you've implemented, and if you can name the company, that's great. If you can't, and you can describe it, that's also fine. But we'd like to get into some practical examples. Joe, can we start with you?
Yeah, I think the best examples around using AI are we've got a couple of partners that we work with now who are taking data about shoppers. They anonymously look at how shoppers move through the store, how staff is moving through the store, and then they're able to, using deep learning techniques, be able to understand what action the shopper and the staff are taking. Are the staff stocking the shelf? Is the customer reaching in the shelf? Are they reaching the top, the middle, or the lower shelf? An example use case, are they trying on the tennis shoes or not? And the ability to then understand how consumers are acting with the product, and so you're able to get the same kind of data that you'd have if you had a staff watching and taking notes on what a shopper is doing. We're able to actually collect the data automatically, and then they can understand better through placing product in the store, how can they maximize the interactivity between the customer and the product.
Now, Intel doesn't really sell anything, do you?
No, I think what we're trying to do at Intel is really foster the innovation and foster the ecosystem of all the partners. And then, in the end, if you're using data, you're going to compute that data, and then Intel sells processing. But it's really much more of an industry lift. And I think for retail, we really believe that physical retail is how consumers prefer to shop. And the challenge has been that the physical retailing experience has kind of gone down. And I think as retailers have been forced through pressures on their P&L to take staff out of the store, it lowers and lowers and lowers that experience. And I think we're at a point where there's maybe a reset needs to happen. And kind of the old model P&L of how you spend your money on technology, staff, inventory, et cetera, need to rebalance that. And I think that if you can bring a bit more of the technology and to help with inventory, to help with understanding how to best position product and help augment what your staff can do, we'll actually find that they can really reverse the trend. And that's what we're seeing with the customers we work with.
So retailers and brands, Intel is open to help. I'm serious. It's an important platform. Forget it, whether it's Intel for the moment, but retailers and brands need support today. Don't you agree? Michelle, give us examples of how this AI is really working for you.
Yeah, so what we do is we're trying to create complete outfits around every product in the catalog. And so in order to do that, well, first of all, the reason you do that is, like I said, you want to get more revenue from your customers, and you also want to save time as a merchant. Because if you could get that same amount of revenue from your customers by manually doing it by hand, you would, but manually doing it by hand is really time consuming. So we're taking time out of the equation, we're giving it back to the merchants. So as part of our value proposition, we can't go to the merchant or to the brand or the retailer and say, we're going to give you all this time back, we're going to give you this upsell opportunity, but on the implementation side, here's 50 things you have to do that are different, because then you lose that time savings. We're just shifting it upstream. That was a really big aha moment in trying to be a startup selling to retailers. Like, no retailer wants to do extra work. So we had to take all that burden and put it on ourselves. So a lot of the place that we use artificial intelligence isn't even in the outfitting. There's a lot in there as well, but it's actually in the setup process, getting the feed from the retailer that they share with every other vendor, so they don't have to customize anything for little old fine mine. They just give us what they have, and then we use machine learning, natural language processing specifically, some other kind of computer vision algorithms to go through that product feed and understand what the products are in the format that fine mine needs in order to be able to create those outfits. So very specifically, we work with brands that have descriptions of their products, but they don't tag them with specific attributes like, what team does this belong to in the athleisure world, or what style does this belong to. So we'll use natural language processing to read through the text of the page that's already there for the consumer and then auto tag those products. Color is another example. A lot of times colors are nonsense words like winterberry. The computer has no idea what that means, but the image has the pixels in the image, and so we use computer vision to extract 7 pixels, so we get 7 different kind of data points about that color in an RGB value, and that's something that the computer can use. So we do all of this stuff during the ingestion and the setup process, so the retailer doesn't have to, because if I went to you as a retailer and I said, hey, get me a product feed that gives me RGB values of each of your products, you'd be like, no deal. We're not going to work with you, Fine Mind. So that's one place we use it.
And what kind of impact has Fine Mind had out in the field?
So our customers see 200% higher revenue from consumers who get the complete outfit, because we see customers who aren't buying products because they're like, oh, I don't know if I can do a fit and flared leather skirt. I don't know if I can pull that off, or it's a little out of my price range. I might pass on it. But if we can show an outfit and they're like, oh, I have a white t-shirt like that. I have a pair of tennis shoes like that. I can pull this off. They might not even buy additional items, but they're empowered to buy that first item.
So if you're doing $100 million in e-commerce revenue, what kind of lift will they see out of Fine Mind?
So we've seen when you do an A-B test and there's a world where Fine Mind exists and there's a world where Fine Mind doesn't exist, the world where Fine Mind exists makes 6% more revenue, so $6 million.
$6 million. That's a nice ROI. And you're charging $5.9 million, is that right?
We try to stay to about a 10-to-1 ratio.
Excellent. Bernd, tell us how it's being implemented in your shop.
Sure. So we are very, very much focused on the the hard problem of with 100% data accuracy determine if a transaction has happened or not. So we decided that if we can solve that problem, then a lot of other additional benefits will basically fall off from the data. So the first product that we're taking to market is basically the idea of a grab and go experience, a completely seamless retail experience in a very small format. I invite you to come see us, but we basically have created a kiosk-style environment where you walk in, you grab the product that you want, and you walk out. So that's at the heart of the offering, and that's what we do, and we know that we have to be 100% right, because nobody will be interested in the system if there's any question that the customer paid for the item, and secondly, that no item does leave the store without being paid.
So you've implemented yet? I mean, you're in the emerging technology showcase, so you get a pass if you don't have a live customer yet. But where are you in that whole implementation phase?
So we don't have a live customer. This is our first public viewing of the technology and the product.
So I'm hoping to see a lot, many of you.
There you go.
By.
Make sure you stop by Burns Showcase.
Marco, tell us how it's actually happening.
Yes, so we, as mentioned before, what we do is inventory scanning, right? So we go around stores, the robots are fully autonomous, they navigate around customers, and actually this is something that is quite interesting because we might think that probably the best time to do an inventory scan is at night, but it turns out that it's actually better to do it in business hours, and we do that as well. So we go around stores, and we are, the ones that we can talk about, we are deployed right now in Lowe's, we're deploying Vevmo. In the case of Lowe's, we're already in all the stores in Silicon Valley in the Bay Area. But we every day go and scan the shelves, we take images, we process those images, and we provide results very quickly. What's missing, what's not in the shelves, planetary compliance issues, pricing issues, out of stock issues, we provide that information. And what is shocking to us is to see all the information that we can gather using machine learning and artificial intelligence of things that we didn't even know, we thought we knew, and the reality is like, wow, this is amazing. And this is really where the power of artificial intelligence comes in. One of the things is, we thought, for example, the robots, when they are scanning, they also help customers, right? We know accurately where every single item in the store is, and then, well, if we can leverage this data now, if a customer comes in, can they ask to the robot where this product is located? So they can actually ask the robot, hey, I'm looking for a paint, or I'm looking for a hammer, I'm looking for a screwdriver. It can actually give you, in real time, the information of that scan, say, hey, this item is located here, and it's in stock, and the robot actually goes and guides you to that product location, while you're following the robot and actually takes you there. Interesting enough, we didn't know what the most common question is for
where's the bathroom?
Where is the bathroom? Number one.
Number one question, retailers. Where's the bathroom?
Where's the bathroom, right. And obviously, we at the beginning, we didn't have it there, but now it was one of the most common questions, so it's now implemented in the robot, and people can ask customer cashiers, customer service, bathrooms.
And is that your robot over there walking?
That's
around?
The one that is there. So it's actually navigating there.
Can it wave to us? Hi, how are you?
Hi. We have it in three locations. We have it at the Microsoft booth. We have it here also in the Innovation Lab, and you guys can come and check it out.
And what's the ROI on one of those things?
Yeah, we're seeing roughly in the first 6 months, roughly 4x.
4x?
Yep.
So if you spent $40 million, no, just kidding. But really, that's an incredible ROI.
Right.
Now, are you using Intel chips in there?
We're using a bunch of things in there. We actually do have Intel products in there.
There you go. Good for you. Joe, so what's keeping us from, you know, you see everything, right? Intel is everywhere inside. Why is this still a conversation? Why are all these people showing up to the AI and robotics panel? This should be boring information at this point.
Well, I think, you know, we actually spend a lot of time wondering why, when we see these amazing return on investments, why we're not seeing scale. And I think fundamentally, you know, retailers are so under so much pressure on their
Mike, are we there?
Why they're under so much pressure on their P&L? And, yeah, use that. I'll lean over. they have tremendous P&L pressure, and you know, hitting their numbers every quarter to the street has driven down their investment on tech dramatically, and it's really put them in a quandary because they can kind of see the challenge they're under, the future pressure, but they don't have the budget to be able to absorb and scale and drive these kind of innovations. And we're very worried, frankly, that how we're going to see physical retailers. What we've found is that there's a new class of retailers emerging. One of our partners coined the digital native term for those retailers, and these are retailers who started online and are now bringing physical stores into the mix, or they're executives who started their career online and they're now leaving online to go start physical brick and mortar stores, and they come in with a list of the data they know they need to run their business effectively, and they design their operation around the data the way an online store would. And what we see with them is a completely different P&L approach to how they resource their business. And I think that retailers are going to have to kind of step back and relook at the mix of spending and realize that in the future, to get the efficiencies they'll need to survive and thrive, they're going to have to go allocate more resource towards tech.
Thanks. So that's a pretty amazing kind of feedback loop, right? Which is that we're just not moving fast enough, and the ones who are moving fast enough are the ones with no infrastructure, the digital natives. Michelle, what's keeping from FindMind being everywhere to tomorrow?
So the thing we're demoing here is with American Eagle Outfitters. We have this partnership between FindMind, Slice, which is a visual search company, and Pandora Bots, which is a company that built a chat bot for American Eagle, where you can go on Facebook Messenger and you can like chat with this artificial intelligence software, essentially. And you can build an outfit through it, and you can recognize an image through it, and all this stuff.
Good.
So it's three companies who use artificial intelligence. Oh. Come on over, Pandora. Oh, no, I'm back. So it's three companies who use artificial intelligence altogether. The problem, I think, is that retailers or anyone who's tried to innovate before may have been burned by visual search or chatbot. I mean, how many times have you heard the word chatbot? It makes me want to like bang my head against the wall. So there's so many companies doing these things now. Some of them do it really poorly. You might try and be like, oh, our innovation team tried a chatbot and it had low ROI. And then you give up and you're like, chatbots aren't for us. So that's a really big risk. Fortunately, we don't have a ton of competitors. Our biggest competitors are retailers manually creating outfits by hand, and it's pretty easy to beat that. So we're a little bit less saturated in terms of like, you know, the compared to visual search or compared to chatbots, but that's such a huge risk. And I think the lesson is don't pick one vendor and then just throw out the whole category because that vendor didn't do a good job. There's so many reasons that your test could fail. And throwing the baby out with the bathwater, you could be losing this massive opportunity. It takes some discipline, and it takes funding, it takes support from your senior executive team. The best innovation teams that we've ever worked with have had their own budgets and have had some insulation, so they didn't have to defend to their senior executives why the ROI on this one tiny experiment in chatbots or whatever it might be that uses AI is so low. They just do it, they learn from the test, they say, here's why the test didn't work, let's change those variables, let's change the vendor maybe, retest it, and then once they get some more serious information, then they can go to their senior executives and say, hey, we know chatbots work, and this is how they work, and here's where we're getting the ROI, and we have a big ask for budget to institutionalize it across the business. So
culture is a big issue here.
Yeah.
So one thing I'd share to the entire audience is not the arch nemesis of retail, but Jeff Bezos is out there doing some amazing things, and he makes a very simple statement. If you're not willing to fail, you're not testing. Testing by definition means you're going to fail over 50% of the time. So if you have a culture internally that doesn't support failure as a learning experience, then you're not really testing, which means you're not going to grow. Fair enough?
Yeah.
Bernd, tell us what's keeping you, well, you're early days, but what kinds of blockades or issues do you see preventing your product from scaling?
Well, I like to think that the things we can do to speed up the process. And definitely, there's a lot of room for the technology to grow and to become more seamless and integrated. But I also think that there's a natural scale and timeline to adoption of, and especially to a technical revolution as massive as AI is in this industry. And I like to think back to the beginnings of RFID when, in the early 2000s, when the barcode had just turned 25 years old. And at that point, it was fairly widely adopted. And we laughed at that, and we says, oh, well, with RFID, it's going to be a couple of years. We're going to be there, right? And here we are 15 years later. We're on a good track, but maybe in another 10, we have a wide adoption, right? I think AI, the bad news is AI is even more revolutionary and more fundamentally driving change than those technologies were. So I think that would suggest that there's time that we need. What's different now, I think, is that retailers have a gun to their head. So I think that will hopefully help us make that change happen and get them to act on all these opportunities that they have. That's my hope.
Okay. And Marco, on the robotics front.
The robotics. I think one of the interesting things is we, as I was saying before, we tend to see this AI, something that is coming in the future, something that we are about to use. But the reality is sometimes we see those things already, again, like as I was mentioning before, Inbox, for example, which is running on Google, it's already using AI, and we're using it every day, and we just don't realize that. If we took a plane to come here, we're already using AI. We don't realize that. So I think there is that perception piece, right? Where we see technologies at some point coming in the future, but in reality, they're already happening in so many ways in our lives that we don't realize that. And suddenly, it's already there, right? So I think it's having that perception a little bit of what's happening right now and actually how we're using these things. And what helps a lot is obviously seeing those ROIs, like the up to 4x%. So we see these things coming, and luckily we have all this amazing data that we can start leveraging, and it becomes easier for, for us to perceive is not really about the AI. The AI is just a tool to get to what these results are. And when that breach happens, things move really quickly.
So is your robot in the position that that original Motorola cellular phone that was like about 20 pounds and everyone laughed at back in the 70s or early 80s, is that the state we're in right now? And when does this thing get to be the size of our iPhone?
Right, and that's a great thing, by the way, because our brains are wired linearly. We think to predict things linearly, but these things are actually moving exponentially. The technologies are moving so quickly, and Moore's Law is one of them, right? Things are moving so quickly in this space that it's hard for us to perceive how things are going to be in 10 years or in 5 years from now. And there is a really quick analogy. If I just give 10 steps linearly, how far I could be, or 30 steps, I'm going to be about 30 meters away. If I give 30 steps exponentially, I have enough steps to go to the moon, to come back, and still circle the Earth 8 times. That's just the way how technology is moving. And it's really hard for us to predict these kind of movements, but suddenly it's going to happen, right? Robotics a year ago, I mean, we don't perceive that, but robotics actually, they used to be back in the day in cages, and we used to see them in manufacturing plants, and they were around cages because they were dangerous, they were just really way too big. But today we see robots in real life environments, in retail stores, in hotels, in hospitals, and it's happening, right? That's the perception, like we don't realize that things are happening, but they are actually happening today.
But they still have the feel of danger, danger, Will Robinson, right? I mean, there's some of that still going on because it's kind of like clunky, right? So when does it become, when do robotics become like not so sketchy and weird and strange? Because that's a pretty unusual looking piece of equipment, right? If that was coming at you in a store, you'd kind of like as a shopper go, whoa, you know, what is this thing? So when does it feel much more natural?
That's interesting because we launched this thing in 2014 in the first store publicly. And the perception is, wow, this is innovation, right? And I think the first thing we saw is like the phones. When we first got a phone and you can see a YouTube video, back in the day, it was like, wow. But now it's like, sure, why not, right? Who's not doing that? And we saw exactly the same thing with the robot piece. The first month, there was a lot of innovation. I was like, wow, a lot of novelty. Who's here? Well, it's a robot and pictures. And the first time we opened in the store, there were like 100 people getting to get into the store to see the robot. After a month, it's so common to see a robot, and specifically in Silicon Valley, I think, because we're used to the tech. But now it's so common to see robots in the store, and we have robots every day in stores, and people just walk in, and sure, a robot is just like another human.
All right, but I got to call you on this. How many people have interacted with a robot in a store? Raise your hand. Okay, where?
A hotel.
Okay, great. Okay, perfect. Keep going.
Yeah, and so we have these robots there, and now it's useful to see them, right? And kids actually go and hawk these robots. So when we're scanning, for example, the robot needs to do a little pause because there's a kid actually hogging the robot. And it happens really often, right? So we focus a lot on making sure the robots look nice, that they don't obstruct with anything happening at the store.
Right.
That's super important. We actually put a lot of effort, and we have people just dedicated in that piece to make sure robots look friendly. They're not there to push people away. They're actually there, and if they see someone, they actually react more politely. If there's someone coming in, it stops. It actually sees that there's a person coming in, and it actually tells jokes sometimes. So we work in all these things to make sure the robots are actually part of the store and not something that is additional to the store.
All right, so one last kind of final question. This is a surprise question, but it should be easy. If everyone in this room could take away one thing, Joe, and I each ask of you, what would it be to make a difference in this whole space?
The one thing I would take away, and I think Michelle brought it up actually, is that the rate and pace of innovation is staggering. And if you tried something 1 year, 2 years, 3 years ago, it's a completely different ballgame today. And so I think if you had that, Intel, we tend to have a problem. Use your mic again.
Yes.
We tend to have a problem at Intel where 10 years ago and it didn't work, so we'll never do it again. And I think that's just a human nature. This world is changing so fast, you've got to keep pulsing and checking because the use cases are maturing and the ROIs are really good.
All right, great. Michelle?
Mine's going to be like super transactional because I feel like everyone says that they want to innovate, but then when it comes down to like how people are given performance reviews and bonused, that doesn't really factor in, especially if you tried something and failed. Like as much as you say, we fail fast and we want to fail and we celebrate failure, like forget all that. Put it in your performance review rubric. how many new things did you try this year? How fast did you get an answer to those questions? Whether that answer was it worked or it didn't work. And then the sidebar to that would be go back and relearn the scientific method. Because one of the things that I found really surprising is when explaining, like when Pano asked how much dollar value to the business did that add, when I explained when we do an A-B test, you know, this group, and the only difference between these two groups, the control and the experiment group, is the existence of FineMind. The FineMind group gets 6% more, and our competitors are going and saying, you know, we get 20% lift when customers interact with our thing. People are like, 20 is bigger than 6, so the competitor's better. I'm like, no, when they interact. And if you take that group that interacts and you put it in an experiment group where people interact and they don't interact and whatever, and then the whole group gets 6% more, that means the people interacting are getting 150, 200%, 250% more. So go back to some basic kind of like science, because if you're going to run these experiments, and especially if you're going to bonus your teams on running experiments, make sure they're running experiments right, because you could get answers to the questions that lead your company in the wrong direction, and that's, you don't want to do that either.
Bernd, what would you recommend?
I want to encourage people to think beyond the retail apocalypse. I think it's actually not happening at all. So change is happening, but if you, for example, look into how many robotic or humanless stores were put in service in 2017, then that's actually, to call it exponential is even an understatement. So those new technologies are there and they're real. If you sit back and you claim retail is dying, then I think you're on the wrong train.
Marco, you got 10 seconds to take us home.
Sure. I mean, I would say probably what is the takeout? I think is we should definitely try new things. Famously known Yahoo CEO back in the day, we did nothing wrong. There are always mistakes that we need to make, and as part of the learning process, definitely.
Excellent. Thank you all for coming. Thank you to the panelists, all of you.
Thank
Most
you
of them are here in the showcase, and Intel is everywhere. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pano. Well done. We'll see you back here in about 30 minutes for another one of our sessions. Thank you so much for coming out.